We're doing great.
Hello, hello, hello.
Yeah, who is it? Yeah, Willow.
It appears that it's working.
Oh, yeah,
It's
good.
showing,
Yeah, this is good. I must have just hit a button or something when I was recording you that I don't know what you're doing, but
All right. Good morning, everyone. So we're going to continue. So this is going to be kind of a shorter lecture, and then I have some data that I pulled from Cowfish and Wildlife that I think we'll explore. Some of it is like shape files for those of you that want to do more GIS. Some of it's just like raw data for like catch per unit angler, but I was hoping we can explore some of that. But so today we're just going to go over harvesting and collection practices. So we talked more about like California fisheries and some Baja Mexico fisheries last week, and a lot of the recreational side. So there's lots of different practices for recreation fishing. Some of them are extremely expensive and not very accessible to most people, right? So like if you are going out locally on fishing the Channel Islands and things like that, you know, all these fancy boats. This boat itself, there's two people on it. It could probably have six people. Like this boat's probably $80,000 to $100,000 to purchase. All the fishing gear and everything that they have is extremely expensive. It's a very expensive sport to go out. You usually don't want to be the person to buy a boat. You just want to have friends with boats. You know, this boat, even a much smaller boat, could easily get out to the Channel Islands and fish. I've been very fortunate to have friends that have boats, and that's kind of where we go. It's local, it's fresh fish. I mean, it's definitely an investment if that's what you wanted to do. Like all my fishing tackle and stuff is I've accrued it since I was, you know, a teenager. But it's not cheap. But there are a lot of accessible kind of fishing. So surf fishing, right? You can go to local beaches. It's a big sport or recreation. You could catch lots of fish. You could feed your family. You don't have to get on a big boat. You could go to your local beach. A lot of these kinds of rods and gear are very cheap. You could just dig in the sand and get sand crabs and things like that, so you can get bait. So it's a lot more accessible and cheap. You might not get the access to these larger mahi-mahi and yellowtail and stuff like that, but I have actually many friends that go surf fishing locally, and they catch halibut, they catch lots of bass, they catch white sea bass. So there's those types of fishing, right? We talked about kind of some of the piers. So a lot of our local piers are very accessible. You don't even have to get a permit, fishing permit, to fish a lot of piers, which makes it a lot more cost effective. So a lot of them are a little overfished now because they are so accessible, but you could still go. And we saw that one person that was fishing on the Avila Pier, and he had a bucket of probably like seven or eight little croakers that probably fed his family that night. And he was catching his own bait too. So probably very cost effective. There's lots of, you know, you can get all fancy and go old school route fly fishing. That's how I started. I would say that that's not mess it's not expensive, but it's more travel, right? If you want to go fly fishing, there's not a lot of local places, so it's going to cost you to go to these fancy places. The Sierras are probably the local, or the Kern River. You could fly fish in the surf if you want to, but you can do that. There's all kinds of fishing coastal. This is my good friend Anupa Azokin. I'm going to talk about her company in a second, her nonprofit she just started. She's amazing fisherwoman. She grew up in Florida in the Keys. So that's a redfish in the Gulf. She's created, she kind of has struggled through a lot of finding employment in various ways. She's on the board of Surfrider. She worked for the NRDC for a while. She worked at Heal the Bay. That's where I met her. Policy, she's worked in DC, and it never just was the right fit for what she wanted to do. So she started her own nonprofit called Fish On, which is pretty awesome. And then even like local lobster, right? You could like hoop net. So this is the type of gear that we can all do. You can't, unless you get like fancy permits and things like that, You know those big like lobster pots you see on Deadliest Catch and things like that? You can't throw those overboard. So you have to have special permits to do that. But if you wanted to catch crabs and lobster, you could, what they're called, hoop nets. And you could easily go and throw gear out. So on the recreation side, the gear is pretty small and limited, not a lot of impact, right? So this is a very sustainable way of fishing. Even if you go out and catch 20 fish a day, which is the limit, bag limit, which sounds like a lot, like one person is not going to make a huge impact with this type of fishing gear. This is, if you want to check it out, Fish On. She started this nonprofit, like it went live like 2 months ago. And so the goal for that is to actually have representation in a lot of these meetings that are going on about, you know, marine protected areas and fishing practices and things like that. She just asked me to write a blog for her website about these new regulations coming out for sand bass. And I'm happy to do it. But what she's been battling as a fisherwoman is the industry. So a lot of the voices that are being, you know, taking over a lot of these hearings and marine protected areas, fishing practices and like that are coming from big business, big fishing business, which are, oops, which are these people, right? People with money. So they're the ones that own a lot of like AFCO and a lot of the fishing, the companies that make all the expensive Shimano, all the expensive rods, reels, things like that. Like this gold reel right here probably costs like $1,200, right? And so it's cheap, right? But there's so much money in this industry. So they have a lot of power. They have a lot of political power when it comes to these decision makings. And it's hard for the average person that's just wants to fish for their family to access these areas to actually have a voice. And so that's what her nonprofit is all about. You should check it out. It's growing. She's already grown quite a bit in just like 2 months. But she's an awesome representative of ocean steward. Does this look like a lot of fish to you? Caught on a boat? Yep. Okay. So this is a limit. So remember, each person can catch 20 fish a day. So that's one person's catch on that boat. That's another person's catch. That's another person's catch. So right there from the top bottom, that's four people's limit on a party boat. So when I say party boat, that's a recreational fishing boat that any of you can go on. You pay about, depends on where you're going out of, what harbor, how long you're going out. So there's half days, there's three quarter days. Those are usually cheap because in a half day, you can't really travel very far. So they'll do more local. You do a three quarter days or a full day, you're going out to the islands. You do a 2 day, 3 day, you're going down to Mexico probably, or like, you know, San Miguel, or you're going out. Each day, one angler can catch 20 fish. And so, and on each one of these boats, you can have up to 40 anglers. That's a lot of fish, right? And that's just one day. If it's a half day boat, then they go out twice a day. So now that boat is doubling up on their fish, right? And so that's just showing you the impact of a recreational fishery. So this is still recreation. You can only use hook and line. You know, there's some boats that during lobster season, you can go out and you can hoop net. So those are usually less people because you don't have enough space, but they'll let you hoop net. But low impact gear, and this is the amount of boats going out of each harbor. So these are the ones that are registered with each harbor. San Diego Harbor is by far the largest when it comes to recreational fishing. Why do you think that is? Close to Mexico. And so it's easy for a half day or three quarter boat to dip into Mexico where there's better fishing and less regulations. If you catch a fish, like say, like our regulations here, bluefin tuna, when we get bluefin tuna coming up to Catalina, you can get two a day. If you go down to Mexico, you can catch a lot more. I think you can catch five. If you catch them in those waters, you're allowed to bring them back as long as they were caught down there, right? So there's a lot of those, but there's also just great fishing down in Mexico, warmer waters. There's some islands that are out there that are just epic for like yellowtail and white sea bass. So a lot of the party boats are stationed up in San Diego or down in San Diego. Dana Point and like I actually didn't even add Oceanside. Oceanside here is like another probably 10 to 15. It's right next to Dana Point. They have a few boats that go out of there. But you know, now let's start doing the math, right? So on average, just with these, so this is from Point Conception, so the Southern California Bight all the way down to San Diego. Depends on each season. Some of these recreational boats are, they're registered as party boats, but they're kind of on the smaller side. So they might have 6 people, 8 people. It might be their temporary or like part-time job, or they might do it seasonally. But on average, there's anywhere between 140 and 220 boats going out every single day, sometimes multiple days, if they're doing half days, and they can take up to 40, 50 people, and each one can take 20 fish. That's a lot of fish, right? And that's just one day. So I'm starting with this. This is out of Dana Fish, Dana Point. So Dana is a big, yeah.
Given the Channel Islands are such a popular and diverse, offer so many diverse species compared to some of the other sites, why is there only 2 to 4 in Santa Barbara?
Santa Barbara is just not a big. They should have more. I think it just the size of the harbor and access. It takes a while to get out there, and there's not a lot of local fishing along the coast. And so when you have like, especially like Dana can go out and they can go to Catalina if they want to, but most of that fishing is like the artificial reef, San Mateo, all that stuff, or there's like rockfish grounds. So there's lots of options, and most of it, especially for the half day, it's more cost effective for them to go just, a lot of times the Dana boats will just go right outside the harbor and they'll go out maybe like a mile or two. And then they just fish for rockfish, whitefish. They load up at sand bass, they load up and then they're back. So they're not spending that much gas. Whereas Santa Barbara, you have to go out. And so I don't think there's a tons of people that want to drive all the way up to Santa Barbara to pay for like, it'd be like a full day. Cause then you'd have to go all the way to like Rosa and then come back.
Those are all day boats or are those overnight too?
They'll do overnights. Yeah, they'll do overnights. It's seasonal. So, I mean, if it's like rockfish season or bass season, or I guess I should say if it's not yellowtail tuna season, then they have, you know, options to go. San Pedro, you go right outside the breakwall. Like they're going, there's a spot that a lot of fishermen fish around us. So this is one of I fish out of the LA Harbor a lot. We have access to all the Cal State Northridge boats where I used to do my master's. I still work with Dr. Steele's husband, Mark. And so he's in SCMI, so it's right in the LA Harbor. So when the boats need hours, we have to go take them to run the motor and might as well fish while we're going out there. So there's a spot that we call Bob in a Box. Bob in a Box is a professor, Larry Allen, who's like this very famous ichthyologist. He was at Cal State Northridge. When his father died, Bob put him in a box and he dropped Bob at his favorite fishing spot. And so that's where Bob wanted to go. That was in his will. So they found when they went out to bury him at sea, they found this awesome rocky reef area that's at about 200 feet. And you could tell on the you know, fishing meter on the bottom depths that it was like a big reef. Drop Bob down, and Bob in a Box is a great fishing spot. So we usually fish Bob in a Box. But that whole area is surrounded by kind of deep water, 150, 200 foot reefs, which is where you catch these rockfish, right? It's very popular. So there's a lot more, going back to what Dr. A asked, there's a lot more of those local spots and off of Los Angeles, out of Dana, out of San Diego, than Santa Barbara. Santa Barbara, you have to travel a bunch, but you still have those options to go out to the islands or go down to Mexico during like major fishing seasons. But I mean, we could do, someone can do the math when we're crunching numbers, but you know, that's a lot of fish. And so one would think that that's a big impact. And it does. Some of it, so some of the numbers that just came out, Cal Fish and Wildlife was doing an assessment of the sand bass fishery. Remember last week, I was talking to you about the calico bass, my favorite bass that I fish, which is like the best tasting bass around. So this one, sand bass is its sister species. So this one's found in the kelp. Sand bass are found in the sand. Most of the time when you fish them, you're essentially fishing for both. But for some reason, there's been an additional pressure on sand bass based off of the recreational fishing. Because you go to these flats, they have these massive spawning aggregations. So during the summer, when they spawn, they all aggregate together. You have thousands of them, and the fishermen will target them. So they'll find these spawning aggregations, fish, 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 take them all out. So now you have like all the boats out of Dana Harbor will swarm around this big aggregation. You have 40 anglers in a boat. You have 20 boats out there. They're just taking them out. So there is some pressure with that, but this has nothing compared to a lot of the commercial fishing pressures that go on throughout throughout the US and throughout the world. Those use different types of fishing practices. So some of them still do actually use pole and lines. A lot of those aren't like the types of poles that I was showing you. A lot of them are heavy duty kind of poles. You see some tuna fishermen that do hook and line where they're basically just like throwing them back. It's actually quite unique. These are like heavy lines, heavy gear, or they'll actually use legit ropes with massive lines and just pull them out. But it is sustainable in that way where they're only limited to a certain amount of catch. These are mostly targeting like tunas, mahi-mahi, which is Dorado, some rockfish, cod sometimes do that, but this is all manually operated. So like the gear, they might have like a little winch or something, but mostly it's just like a pole or a line that comes out. The long lining, which I'll show you in a second, is the unsustainable practice. So this is just like lines that go like football fields long with tons of different hooks, and there's a lot of bycatch involved, right? So if you have tons of hooks, which means tons of bait, now you have sharks coming in, you have birds that are diving down and getting snaggled in all the lines because there's multiple hooks and multiple lines, and it can be really kind of catastrophic for a lot of bird populations. The US and some other, regions of the world have put some regulations in on hook and line fishing. One of them is the hook shape. So they'll use these, what's called circle hooks. Circle hooks are, they're like this. So if this was like the eyelid, they'll come around and they hook around like this. And so if a bird comes in, it actually, it's hard for the actual barb to catch it. You actually have to have the fish come in and they'll hook almost their bottom lip. So it works really well with fishing, but it prevents a lot of diving birds and stuff to get hooked. Also the depth. So a lot of these kind of long lines. So this is a long line. They'll require you at certain areas to fish at certain depths. So that way it does, limit the amount of birds that can dive down and get tangled up. The long lines can be somewhat unsustainable, or they can have a lot of bycatch. So the way that they mitigate that, they'll weight the lines. So a lot of these lines that they put out, they'll go to depths. They have these very fancy fish finders, right? So they can actually tell where the schools of fish are, and they can target them. And again, this looks kind of small, but like these boats will have football field long lines that have hundreds and hundreds of hooks all baited up, and it's on a winch. And so they'll find these big schools, they'll pull these things through, and they'll wait until You have a bunch of rockfish, the like cod, halibut, things like that are big long lining species or target species. And they can be really detrimental. So that's like a long line. So you can actually see it's like a rope. And it's just tons of hooks that are right next to each other. I mean, these are massive, which look like cod or pollock or something like that. These are massive fish. And this could go on for you know, like a mile sometimes. I think they have calculated some of these longer boats have like long lines of a mile. Sometimes it's, you have to be in really open water. You have to make sure that you're not getting tangled on anything. But they're definitely football fields long. So talk about the pressure of that, right? One boat now with one fishing practice that's very unsustainable can have a huge impact on a population. And so just going back to like what we thought about what this recreational fishing is doing, which is very targeted, very low impact gear, can still have an impact. Just think of this, right? And this is going on worldwide. We have some regulations in the US, they're pretty good for limiting this, but many countries throughout the world don't have any regulations. You could just fill up your boat and go. It's pretty, pretty gnarly. Gill nets are one of the bad ones. So I remember still vividly when, so I talked to you about the fishing area that I went to in Baja Sunchion, in Mexico a few years ago. So that's the place that I was talking to you about that has the big lobster fishery, that they protect that lobster fishery. It's a co-op, it's run by the community, but they also do gill nets. And when I went out the first day we got there, we're all stoked. We cracked open some beers, we were getting all of our fishing gear ready, and this big panga came in. So pangas, they're the type of boat that they use a lot in Baja and throughout Mexico. You could tell that they just pulled in a massive gill net. So these gill nets are floating. So these can be miles long. And we don't allow gill nets that long in the United States anymore. I think we banned them in the 70s, maybe early 80s. Dr. A might know that. But many countries still use this practice. So this is a floating net. The difference between this and a drift net is these larger nets, if they're just drifting out at sea, there's nothing anchoring them down. That's called a drift net. Same type of net, but if you anchor it down to the ocean floor, so it's actually fixed, but it's still just taking up space in the water column, that's a gill net. The whole goal is for something to swim into it and not come out. Really depends on the what fish you're targeting is the type of mesh that you have. So if you have smaller fish, you know, smaller sand dabs or bait fish, mackerel, things like that, you're going to use a smaller mesh. What's kind of the disadvantage to that is if you have larger fish that go into those, they'll tear up the net, right? So if you're targeting larger fish, which is typically the case, they'll have really large mesh, which means really thick rope type structures. So if a whale cruises into it, if a dolphin cruises into it, if a turtle cruises into it, it's not coming out. These are very detrimental to the ocean environment. But they catch a lot of stuff, which is why if you are in a country that don't have many regulations, you can use these, you can catch a ton of stuff, provide for your families or for your country, and you know, you're gonna have to deal with a lot of bycatch. Drift nets are completely banned in California. And so this is a smaller gill net, right? So you can just see everything's tangled up. This is kind of the goal for it. This is a very fine mesh. And so it's targeting a lot of smaller fish, sand dabs, mackerel, things like that. But this net would just get torn apart if you're going for, you know, like larger halibut or tunas, things like that. So these can get very, very large and very kind of thick, and they're pretty intense. Questions on any of those practices so far? Well, it's more, so it's more a gill net when it's in a fixed position instead of drifting is a better practice, but you still with those gill nets are because with a net like that where you can fix the you might be able to exclude larger mammals or things like that from getting in those areas. But you're still going to have birds dive bombing. You can still have things that you're not actually targeting, turtles, things like that get into it. So it's still going to produce bycatch. You might be able to limit some of the larger ones. The drift nets, they just let them drift. And so who knows what can get into them. They're both pretty unsustainable practices. Yeah. A drift's going
to
drift.
There was a webinar I was supposed to do today that they canceled last minute about ghost nets. There's an update of this sort of inventory across the world, but I was hoping to give you an update, but since they canceled the webinar, I can't give it.
Yeah, these are also called ghost nets. You just don't know where they go, or a lot of times they'll drift off and people lose track of them, whoever's fishing them, and then all of a sudden they're tangled around a blue whale, and you know, you get the net when it washes up on shore. Sharks too. So a lot of sharks, a lot of your larger makos, blue sharks, hammerhead sharks, white sharks, well, get caught in these heavily. Nope. I mean, it depends. So, it really depends on the fishery. I think if you know your coastal waters, and especially like if you're going for smaller fish like this, then you might just set it out for like 12 hours or 16 hours or 24 hours, something like that. If you want to maximize your catch, you might just leave it out for a few days. And there's a lot of times you know, especially in unregulated waters, they're just going to set out a bunch of these and then they're going to wait the longer that there's, it's called soaking. So when you have a net that's either staying there or a crab pot and you're letting it just sit there, it's called soaking. The longer you have it soaked, the longer or the more, you know, fish you're going to potentially get. So, going back to Baja Sanchion, when they were pulling up this big net, I was like, oh my gosh, what are they catching? Is it gonna be yellowtail? Is it gonna be? And so it was a bunch of rockfish, and then there was this massive, like 16-foot hammerhead shark. And so they pulled this whole hammerhead shark up, and this guy had like a machete, and he's just like hacking away at this hammer. But they were not intent because you could tell actually the hammerhead was tearing up their net. But that's a lot of meat, right? And they don't have regulations down there for that. So that hammerhead was bycatch. So it's pretty, yeah, it's pretty intense. But
Carson,
it,
Carson.
oh yeah, of course.
Those kind of stuff banned recreationally, right? The only thing you can do recreationally is line and then small traps for bait fish.
Yeah, good question. Yeah. So recreationally, when you get a fishing permit, you can use general gear. So one rod is your main fishing permit. You can get a enhancement stamp for like $5 extra, so you could have two rods in the water at once. You can't have more than two rods in the water at any time. Any of us.
Like you have four, two people on a boat, you could have
You
four.
have four. Yep. Unless you're doing like research, so like you know, working in San Diego with Dr. Steele, he has permits to do multiple rods, right? So that's a but that's a scientific collecting permit. That's not a recreational fishing permit. So you could do that. You could do the hoop nets. You're allowed up to seven of those to soak at one time. And so typically, when we go out and do that, you're just letting them soak for like 2 hours. So by the time you like drop one and then you go and you drop one, they all have little glow sticks because we're usually doing it at night. That's when lobsters come out. By the time you get to the last one, like you're already swinging back to pick up the first one. So they're not in the water very long. They don't have a lot of things to get tangled on. So very rarely do you get anything really. It's usually like another boat, if like a boat drives over it. And then spear fishing gear. So you can use for a recreational permit, you could use spear guns or, you know, the spears or any kind of practice like that. But you cannot use any of this. You have to get a commercial fishing license and you have to pay, and it costs a lot of money to do it. So it really is only advantageous for someone that's going to be selling it at a market, making a business out of it. Good questions. Purse seine is an example of a fishing practice that is fairly sustainable. This is how, like, if you go to any harbors and there's like bait docks where you can get anchovy or sardines, they're using purse seines. This could be unsustainable. But in the United States, we have regulations for this. If you go and you get like some tuna, so this is commonly used for tuna, you have big schools of tuna, and this boat will just have this massive net that will surround the tuna, and then you pull the bottom tight, and then so they're kind of, you know, corralled in. And so this is here's a picture of a boat that's doing kind of small scale, right? But if you have, this would be like a sardine school or anchovy school, but you can imagine the ones for like big tuna schools. If you go and you have a can that says dolphin safe tuna, they have to, they're required by their permits to make sure that there's no dolphins or any marine mammals around these big corrals, right? So they have spotters. You can't see this now, but there's like boats that have like multiple platforms, right? So like 3-4 stories tall. They have a spotter up here that's helping them. And they're actually using drones a lot now for spotting tuna. Fishing lingo, so you're all like pros when you go fishing for the first time, is called puddling. And so when you see tuna on the surface, all especially when there's like hundreds or thousands of them, they change the way that the surface of the water is moving. So you'll have waves coming in, and then all of a sudden they'll just be like almost like a dead spot, and it looks like a puddle that's just kind of fluctuating. It's all of their fins that are creating that different wave movement. And so they'll send out either the spotters or they'll send out drones to find them, and then they'll corral them. But before they actually cinch it up, they have to make sure that there's no dolphins or marine mammals or any bycatch in it. And they're regulated to do that in especially our waters. So that's what dolphin safe means when you go get those cans. But this is very large for the main practice for sardines and anchovies, mackerel, tuna. So all these larger schooling fish that you'll see. Sustainability effective for schooling species with low bycatch. So those are the ones that are usually certified. These can catch juvenile dolphins if poorly managed. So countries that don't have these regulations, China's the main culprit for this. And I'll talk about their fishing industry in a second. They'll pull it up and they'll have a bunch of tuna and they'll have dolphins and marine mammals and stuff in it as bycatch. So, that's why they have that tuna safe gear limit regulation. Pots and traps. We kind of just talked about pots and traps. So there are, you know, we've all seen like Deadliest Catch, or at least seen some of the clips of it. So they're throwing out single pots usually. And so those are going deep water. When we go out here, sometimes if you're driving along the coast, you'll see like little buoys. So those are all pots too. They're going for Dungeness crab, for lobsters. Actually, one of the biggest fisheries for pots here that most people don't know about is sheephead. So live sheephead is huge industry in Japanese, Korean, Chinese cultures, and they actually want them live. So there's fishermen here that will catch live sheephead. Sheephead is like one of the ugliest fish you'll ever see. So they have these monster teeth. This is a big male. Females are pink. They still have these like big teeth. So these are actually really great. So they're one of the predators for the purple urchins that we just ate on the trip. So they'll crunch up, and they have like these this super indestructible intestine that's just loaded with ligaments and fat, so they can actually digest the spines of urchins. But they want these alive, so they'll have big tanks and they'll ship them to Asian fish markets. I think it's just a cultural thing out there. I think a lot of the fish that goes into the fish markets, they prefer alive, or they'll spend, I should say this, they'll spend a higher premium for them when they are coming alive. I'm sure they'll eat them when they're dead. They're kind of a weird fish because the texture of them, it's almost like lobster meat. And so it's I'm not a big fan of sheephead. I'll put it in like soups and stuff like that, but it's a very different type of meat. But there's all different types of ways of doing pots and traps. So lobsters, crabs are typical, actually fishing for octopus. So octopus fisheries use traps. They can may be made from all types of gear. Typically, they're with different wires, metal wires and stuff like that. But you could have wood, you could have plastic. Really depends on the types of species you're going for. For us out in California, you can only deploy them for 24 hours. And so after 24 hours, you have to pick them up. And so a lot of times, at least the local fisheries, they'll go out and they'll drop a bunch of them at night or right before sunset. They'll let them soak throughout the night, and then they'll come pick them up the next day. And so they're pretty minimal bycatch with these because they're smaller, but it's really like the ghost fishing again. A lot of times they can, especially if there's high seas and big surf, they can kind of get pulled up. And we find them a lot on Rosa, right? So they'll actually in Santa Cruz, they'll just get washed up on the beach. And so when it comes to that, they can be pretty detrimental, cause a lot of damage. Dredging is a big one. So this is big for like the scallop and clam industry. So they'll actually dredge the bottom with these big nets. So this is kind of a example of that. And so some of these actually have teeth. And so you can't use these in California, at least not to my knowledge. We don't really have like a big scallop fishery. Our scallops here are rock scallops, so you have to like actually go and pluck them off rocks. But this is more for like tropical scallops. And they're basically just destroying the ocean floor. Dr. A showed you some images a couple weeks ago of the Oculina fish, or the MPA, and how they go through and they kind of trawl and dredge those systems, and they just leave these big kind of plow marks and just destroy the habitat. This is what this does. And so extremely unsustainable, destroys a lot of benthic habitats. There's a lot more sustainable options for this. If you want scallops and if you want clams, you could just be a smart consumer and you can get them a lot more sustainably. But especially the ones that have like legit teeth, like they are extremely, extremely destructive. Do you know where's like the closest fishery for dredging? I think it's more, I mean, it's mostly tropics. I don't know. Yeah. Pretty intense. And then we have our trawls. So this is kind of like the last couple types of practices. We have trawls. We actually have part of the Cal State Consortium is at Southern California Marine Institute. We have a boat called the Yellowfin. And so I'd love to get to the point where we can actually, maybe for like fish and fisheries class, take students out on the Yellowfin because they can do trawls. You can do trawls at any depth. So like midwater trawls are, is what they say, midwater. So you can target different types of species depending on their depths. Usually when you're in a fishery, those fishers know the type of fish, how they school. It's pretty amazing. Like, you know, everyone's probably seen like a fish finder before, right? And like the different shapes. The fishers can actually tell you what type of fish it is just by the mark, and how they're schooling and how they're behaving. It's a whole unique language. And so they can actually be like, oh no, this target fish is, that's a small bait fish. We don't want that. Oh, these fish down here, that's what we want. And so they can drop these trawls down to whatever depth. Midwater trawls are, you know, they're not hitting the bottom. So they might not have that kind of larger kind of metal plow on the bottom, and they just catch a lot of fish. A lot of these pelagic trawls can be very, very large. So, you know, you can imagine this is an otter trawl, and, you know, this net, even though this isn't really causing a lot of damage, this is kind of keeping the net open. Some of these pelagic trawls can be quite long, like the size of a football field or larger type. And so you can catch a massive amounts of fish in one go around. And so I try to keep reminding, or like, you know, bringing this back to, you know, we have these recreational boats where you can go out and have fun and catch a ton of fish for a half day, three quarter day. But if you have this boat go out for a half day pulling this net, like that's equivalent to that 100, 140 recreational boats going out in Southern California, the amount of fish that you can catch. And that's happening worldwide, right? So that's why a lot of our fisheries are getting depleted at a very high rate. This is a cool technology. So this type of fishing method does have some bycatch. Maybe it's the next slide. Sea turtles are one of the big ones. Depending on where I'm going, marine mammals can get in there, diving birds, especially once these nets get full and they come closer to the surface, diving birds will come in and get closed up. But a sea turtle will go through, and there's actually this really cool device. It's called the TED, turtle exclusion device, that NOAA created, that has helped with a lot of the turtle bycatch. Check it out.
The shrimp fishery is the largest fishery in the Southeast United States. It employs a lot of people. It's been around a long time, so it's part of the culture. It's really important fishery in the Southeast. And so, but because of the design of shrimp trawl, it's basically a funnel that catches anything that's passed. It catches a lot of things that we do want to catch, but also catches things we don't want to catch, like endangered sea turtles. And because of the laws involving endangered sea turtles, we must reduce the take of sea turtles on the trawl. Because of that, we've been working with the industry over 30 years to develop a turtle excluder device, which has been extremely successful in the fishery. A turtle excluder device is basically a grid that's placed in the trawl. The grid has a bar spacing of 4 inches or less, and it's placed in a trawl on an angle. So as the catch goes through the trawl, anything small enough to pass through the grid passes into the bag or tied into the net and gets caught. Anything that's larger than the bar spacing is directed by the water flow out in the escape opening that's placed strategically in the TED. And so large skates, rays, sharks, anything that are too large to fit through the bar spacing are excluded out of the TED. And there's a flap that keeps the opening closed when nothing is going out to prevent shrimp escape. So it's been very effective to not only reduce the sea turtles, but other large catch, but unwanted catch, such as sharks and rays.
You have these large kind of bars that are coming off of the side of the boat to like widen out the net for the otter trawls, keep it spread out. There's that TED. Pretty low tech, but it works.
The fact is low tech is a good thing, right? In the ocean with seawater and everything, it's simpler the better.
Ooh. There it goes. That's caught. That's going on your dinner plate. Another fish taco. There it goes. So this is a bottom trawl, right? So now we're seeing in action. It's just, this is a sandy bottom. It still can be detrimental to a lot of different types of fish, invertebrates. Largest fish. Oh, that's sea turtle, never mind. Oh. It goes in and then it's boom, excluded. There it goes. Super low tech. But, you know, does the job. So Noah's come up with actually a couple really cool, like, fishing methods improvement with bycatch. This is one of them. There's also for... like rock fishing, I mentioned this before. So rock fish are like all those red fish that are on the boat that I showed you. Bottom fish, you can fish for them here. You'll catch them in 50 feet all the way down to like 600, 800 feet. And so the deeper ones have to go through a massive pressure change, right? And so by the time you get them up, a lot of times their gas bladder is that comes out of their mouth. Right. So they depressurize. So there's no way that they can actually get back down. If you were to just say you catch a little small one and you want to throw it back, or you catch an endangered one and you can't actually harvest it, you in that case, you actually technically have to throw it back. But if you throw it back, that fish is just floating at the surface. It cannot go back down. So there's two different ways that you can actually get it back down. You can degas it with a needle. And so I always have a needle on me and but I know exactly where the gas bladder is, so I could actually depressurize it. You can only do that if the gas bladder is still in the body. So a lot of times they'll come up and they're buoyant, but the gas bladder hasn't come out yet. So you go, you know, kind of right behind the pelvic fin and you pinch it. If you've ever seen like a medical video, like when the punctured lung and they go clear and they like push through, that's essentially what you're doing, right? And then it's like psst, and so you actually purge it out and then they can swim down. Most people don't know how to do that, or they're not comfortable doing that and they don't know the right spot. And so for that, or the case where the gas bladder's out, they have these descending devices. So we always have also on our boat one rod. It's usually our old piece of crap rod that we don't want to catch any fish on. And you have this descender. It's a big weight and it's like this metal clamp. And you clamp it onto the mouth of on the lip of the fish, right? So it's just like, you know, us grabbing the fish like this. It's the same thing. It clamps it down. And then it's under tension. And so once you drop it, once it gets to a certain pressure in the water, it releases. And so it'll release the fish at depth and then it can swim away. So it's a pretty cool advancement. Again, super low tech. These are all kind of advances that NOAA Fisheries has helped. And I think this is the last, yeah.
You said that centers use gas bladders to spell.
That could, yep. Goes back in. Yep. Once it's like, so once it comes out, it's very rigid. It's very pressurized. And so once it depressurizes, it'll go right back in. Yeah. You don't have to pop that. No. And typically you don't want to pop it when it's like that. The real big issue, which is kind of, you know, it's, you'll never get back. Like even if you send it back, they're never going to recover from, is when their eyes are pop out. And so when we know that we're fishing for, this is just an educational thing. When people are fishing at like deeper than 200 feet. If you catch something, you just have to reel it in real slowly. So you can't just do the, I got something. Everything will be popping out. And it's like, you either have to take that home or you are feeding a seagull with it. It's not going to go back down. But if you go up real slowly, they'll be buoyant, but you could definitely put it back down on a descender and they'll recover and they're good to go. So, and this is all stuff like, I wish Noah had more resources and Fish and Wildlife had more resources to go onto these boats and to talk to people about it. Because, you know, the more of the, if you catch a little fish like this, you might not, you know, want to have to deal with it. Or you don't want that to go towards your 20 bag limit, right? Because you're not going to be bringing a lot of fish in. But if you send that fish back down and you give it another year or two, now it's a reproductive individual that can provide more fish for you in the fishery. Yeah. No course.
About these things, and people have to pass some sort of test to get the license.
Sure, I think that'd be great. I think even if it's just like a little online kind of 20-30 minute thing, you have to also think there's a lot of people that you'd have to make it in a way that would be attentive. I've actually thought about this before. If you actually made it into like a fishing video, fishers love just watching like people catch fish. I can watch fishing videos all day long, and I do on Sundays. If you kind of made it like that and less like, you know, Fish and Wildlife telling you regulations, I think people would watch it. If it's more policy bureaucratic, I think there would be less people interested, but I think that's a great idea. And like, you know, every 5 years or something, every 3 years, you have to get refreshed. But as of now, they don't have that. Yeah, unfortunately. This is the last, so this is essentially the same trawl, but this is on the bottom. You can do these still, and so you can do midwater and bottom trawls in California. Our yellowfin, our research vessel, will go do bottom trawls. They'll only do them in kind of deep water sandy habitat, so they're not pulling it over reefs. It's really destructive when you have like those oculina reefs or some other structures and you're decimating them. But you're still, you know, even sandy habitat is still habitat for many different types of animals. We get a lot of, when you do the bottom trawls with the yellowfin, we'll get lots of rock shrimp, prawns, things like that. But this is definitely practice. The midwater ones are less impactful to habitat, right? So ideally, if you're going to do a trawl, you do a midwater trawl. It has those ability to get bycatch. You can also get bycatch with the bottom trawls too, sharks, things like that. But they're really destructive to the ecology and to the ecosystems. Shrimp, this is like a big way of collecting shrimp is bottom trawling. Cod's a bottom dwelling fish, flounders, halibut, things like that. But they can't, so this is an example of a long trawl net, right? And so loaded with different fish, this size net could easily catch multiple dolphins, multiple sea lions, or, you know, sharks and things like that. So you want to have those practices. A lot of times I do see these types of boats pull in and there'll be a large shark and they throw it overboard and it will, you know, do fine. I think if you're, you know, aware that you have that possibility, the fishers that are on the deck ready to take these nets in are looking for that so they can react quick. That would be a good sustainable steward of the ocean. When you're going to other regions of the world, that might not be the case. It might be get everything in and we're harvesting everything. Everything can go to market. And especially if there's no regulations on it, whether you're doing that, you know, sustainably or not, this was like going through a dredge of some type of rocky reef structure. There's evidence of scallops, so maybe they were going for scallops in this fishery. But, you know, you're kind of clear, it's like clear cutting the forest in some sense, right? You're just plowing through these systems and removing a lot of habitat that can be extremely, extremely destructive. So We'll wrap up with this, and I have one short video to show you from one of my favorite scientists. Who do you think are the largest countries that, like, the largest fishing pressure in the world by metric tons? China, okay, China's number one. Who else? Japan. Mexico.
Just in general or just in our region?
No, in the world. Who are the largest kind of fishing industries based off of metric tons? India, I guess. We're on the list. So we're eighth. So metric tons, China by far outfishes everybody. They have a lot of people, but they, so this is based off of the 2023 metrics. So they don't, China has very little fishing regulations. As Dr. A mentioned, China's in his fishing, like with like toothfish and slime fish and all that, they're actually getting permits in different countries to fish other countries' waters. So they're not actually, that's not just fishing off of China. China has fishing boats all over the world, but that's what they're pulling in. Indonesia's huge. India, I don't know why there's all these spaces in my thing.
Like regulation?
I think that's a big thing. It's also, they have a large population and their culture is very much seafood based. But this is fisheries production with aquaculture and fishing, though. I forgot to mention that. So this is just all of their fishing production. And when I say fishing, that's fish, that's invertebrates, you name it, by metric tons. Right, we're down there just a fraction of what China's doing, but you still have some players in here that you wouldn't kind of think about, right? Peru, Chile, Norway's always kind of like a fishing community. They have a lot of cod and things like up there, Bangladesh. I think a lot of these countries, though, I'd be interested to dive in to see how much of their fishing is actually coming from permits to other countries, right? I don't know. I mean, Peru, there's seafood in Peru, especially Chile. Like, Chile is actually quite, that doesn't surprise me, but I wonder if they are giving out some fishing permits to other countries and that's going to those numbers.
Yeah, the first time I was on a factory trawler was in Chile in like the early 90s, and we reduced the fishing pressure on crabs in Alaska because we were worried about overfishing. And so instead of just those fishing vessels like stopping, they went to the other hemisphere. And so they were contracted, when I was on board, was contracted by Chile to go do exploratory fishing. So they were coming out of Pinochet regime, and they were trying to move towards democracy and all that kind of good stuff. And so they were trying to be more responsible about the resources. So this fishing vessel essentially contracted by the government to go to different places and just put the nets in the water. It's like, what the hell's here? How many fish are here? I do surveys essentially. And then the payment that the fishing operator got was 6 months of unlimited fishing in the waters. So when they were done, they could just take whatever they want, go wherever they want, wow, take as much as they want for 6 months. And I remember Brenton was mentioning a lot of sort of Southeast Asian, Japanese, sort of seafood-oriented cultures. Some of the inspectors on there were from Japan, and they were just there to look at the quality of the fish that was coming out. And they were the happiest seafood people I've ever seen. There was all this insane fish coming up that mostly couldn't throw into a processor and didn't know what it was. And they were just, whoa! And they like grabbed this out. Like, we're eating this tonight. Like, whoa! We're eating this crazy, deep water eel or something, whatever.
It's crazy.
So, yeah, so the movement around. And the other one to just mention about the China thing is that that's FAO. Those are FAO numbers?
Yeah.
Yeah. So those are FAO numbers. So don't know what the real number is. Guarantee that's not the real number.
Yeah.
So China, runs everything that China touches with regards to this stuff. And their institutional There's institutional misinformation about stuff. So clearly they're absolutely the largest in the world, but I would bet you $1 billion that it's not 88, wasn't 88.5 million metric tons in 2023.
No.
And that's everybody understands that. So most of the global fishing statistics you'll see will be global and then global without China, because it's difficult to understand the reality because their stuff is so difficult, you know, unhinged from reality. Unfortunately, our country might be joining them soon.
I mean, seriously, yeah.
Less. So the issue there is historically there's been institutional incentives to meet standards. Hey, we want you to bring in, you know, 10 tons of fish from this fishery, and the guy comes to the dock and he only has 8, and so then he reports it, and the guy that's doing the report, they better say it's like 8.5, and then his boss goes, we only 8.5, we make it 9, and then so it's not even that someone's like telling you to lie, it's just the system incentivizes people to exaggerate. And there's also lying too, but just inherent nature of the way the system goes, it's pretty bad.
And so the larger, I was actually surprised on this. The species that they target the most that goes towards this metric tonnage is Alaskan pollock. So I thought it was going to be, but that's what, so, you know, Alaskan pollock is there's bottom fish, pollock industry. There's, you know, so many different uses for it. There's probably a lot of things that you've eaten that you didn't realize that you were eating pollock. It's kind of like a cod type of fish. Like fish and chips. Yep.
Play a fish.
Yep. Pollock. Nice buttery white fish. Delicious. So where do you go from there? So I thought we would, I always like to throw in videos so it changes up the pace. This is from Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson, TED Talk. I always like these little mini short TED Talks.
Fish are in trouble. The cod population are predators collapsed in the 1990s. Intense recreational and commercial fishing have decimated Goliath grouper populations in South Florida, and most populations of tuna have plummeted by over 50%. With the southern Atlantic bluefin on the verge of extinction. Those are just a couple of many examples. Overfishing is happening all over the world. How did this happen? When some people think of fishing, they imagine relaxing in a boat and patiently reeling in the day's catch. But modern industrial fishing, the kind that stocks our grocery shelves, looks more like warfare. In fact, the technologies they employ were developed for war. Radar, sonar, helicopters, and spotter planes are all used.
So a lot of the larger tuna fisheries have helicopters and spotter planes now. Yeah.
Wrapped up massive amounts of fish, along with other species like seabirds, turtles, and dolphins. And fish are hauled up onto giant boats, complete with onboard flash freezing and processing facilities. All of these technologies have enabled us to catch fish at greater depths and farther out at sea than ever before. And as the distance and depth of fishing have expanded, so has the variety of species we target. For example, the Patagonian toothfish neither sounds nor looks very appetizing, and fishermen ignored it until the late 1970s. Then it was rebranded and marketed to chefs in the US as Chilean sea bass, despite the animal actually being a type of cod. Soon it was popping up in markets all over the world and is now a delicacy. Unfortunately, these deep water fish don't reproduce until they're at least 10 years old, making them extremely vulnerable to overfishing when the young are caught before they hatch.
A lot of our local like rockfish are the same way. They don't reproduce until they're much older.
It's considered such a delicacy in China and Vietnam that the fin has become the most profitable part of the shark. This leads many fishermen to fill their boats with fins, leaving millions of dead sharks behind. But problems aren't unique to toothfish and sharks. Almost 31% of the world's fish populations are overfished, and another 58% are fished at the maximum sustainable level. Wild fish simply can't reproduce as fast as 7 billion people can eat them. Fishing also has impacts on broader
We're at 8 now.
Wild shrimp are typically caught by dragging nets the size of a football field along the ocean bottom, disrupting or destroying seafloor habitats. The catch is often as little as 5% shrimp. The rest is bycatch, unwanted animals that are thrown back dead. And coastal shrimp farming isn't much better. Mangroves are bulldozed to make room for shrimp farms, robbing coastal communities of storm protection and natural water filtration, and depriving fish of key nursery habitat. So what does it look like to give fish a break and let them recover? Protection can take many forms. In national waters, governments can set limits about how, when, where, and how much fishing occurs, with restrictions on certain boats and equipment. Harmful practices such as bottom trawling can be banned altogether. And we can establish marine reserves close to all fishing to help ecosystems restore themselves. There's also a role for consumer awareness and boycotts to reduce wasteful practices like shark finning and push fishing industries towards more sustainable practices. Past interventions have successfully helped depleted fish populations recover. There are many solutions. The best approach for each fishery must be considered based on science, respect for the local communities that rely on the ocean, and for fish and wild animals. And then the rules must be enforced. International collaboration is often needed too, because fish don't care about our borders. We need to end overfishing. Ecosystems, food security, jobs, economies, and coastal cultures all depend on it.
So we're gonna talk more. So my goal for this kind of three class session was to go more local, less class, get the language down for practices this class. And then next, or on Thursday, we're going to talk about kind of the history. So we'll talk about kind of indigenous fishing, and especially with local Chumash. We'll talk about like a lot of the larger like cod kind of examples that have like started wars and things like that. And then kind of the future with aquaculture and stuff. But to kind of get back to, you know, you can say it so much, but you really have to be passionate about it. I have this example. So when I go back east and I visit my wife's family, they like seafood. We go out to dinner all the time. And my one thing that I tell everybody is if you want to make a difference, you need to make like a couple changes. First one is stop eating shrimp. And everyone's just like, oh my gosh, like I just love shrimp. I love shrimp so much. It's like shrimp. But it goes back to like our conversations around the campfire, where if you start expanding your palate a little bit, you might not need that shrimp, right? You can find other things to eat. And so I was talking to my father-in-law. We were sitting at this seafood restaurant in South Carolina, in Myrtle Beach, and talking to everybody about it. I'm like, you know, if you can do one thing for me, is just stop eating shrimp. Stop eating shrimp. Oh, I can't. I just love it so much. I just can't. Okay. And so we're going through, and I was going through the menu, and I'm telling them all the things that are sustainable. Hey, Skip, you can have this. Hey, Skip, you can have that. Look at this. This is sustainable. This is sustainable. And the waiter comes over and goes, give me the grilled shrimp. And I was just like, all right. Well, that's a big F you. But like, so clearly, you know, he's kind of an old curmudgeon, and he, you know, probably is like, he's fixed on his ways. He's going to eat shrimp until he dies. But like, you can start making a difference. And so, especially with restaurants and stuff, if they're getting less people that are ordering these things and different types of foods, different types of pallets, they're going to start having. I mean, there's been a huge change just with the uni fishing. So there's like a lot of restaurants now that have Santa Barbara uni that you weren't really finding 5-10 years ago in the local fish markets. It's because it's high demand for it. So you can choose sustainable seafood. You can have that Seafood Watch app, the Monterey Bay Aquarium. You have that. Support local fisheries. We have lots of local fisheries here that you can support. Avoid exploited species. Hopefully now you have a better idea. Like, it's not just saying like a lot of these fish are overcaught. Some of them are, many of them are, like tunas and billfish, things like that, shrimp. But knowing the practices now. So every time that you eat a shrimp, think about the way that it was caught, right? It was likely caught with that massive trawl net that dragged across the ocean floor. And then that shrimp was packaged and shipped probably overseas. And then back here so you could have that little fish taco. Is it worth it? All right. So you can make more sustainable choices, and you should not be, you know, scared to make other people feel bad about themselves when they eat these things. You can do it in a way that, you know, it's education. A lot of people don't know this. You might not have known a lot of these things until today or last week. But once you learn about it, and especially those that are connected to the ocean, they'll hopefully make more choices. What's up, Dr. Reinemann? Diversify seafood choices. We talked about that, and reduce waste. Especially I always find I wish Alex Minks was here. The vegetarians of the world think that, you know, they're, I don't know his practice, but his is more health related, he told me. But there's a lot, I have many friends that, you know, don't want to kill animals. And the whole reason behind being vegetarian is not killing animals. I totally understand and appreciate that. You should also realize that most of the vegetables that you eat are grown with fertilizers that come from fish meals and chicken meals and all that stuff. So it's actually all the waste from these harmful practices that are growing your tomatoes and your peppers and your vegetables. And so you should think about that when you're making those types of decisions. But that's a different conversation for another day. I just want to wrap, I didn't have a slide for this, but I want to wrap around to coastal management, right? So these are all practices that are happening with, you know, throughout the world. What's unique about the United States, we have a federal agency, NOAA, that regulates all of our ocean kind of waters. And so that goes to the practices, the types of gear that you're used. So that's throughout our country. Regulations or types of bycatch restrictions, things like that. And then each state, coastal state, has their own fish and wildlife. So we have Cal Fish and Wildlife that monitors our specific fisheries. And so here we have different offices. They're given different ranges. So there's the South Coast one that's like San Diego, right? So they're regulating, they know the specifics of each fishery. So they know how many calico bass and sand bass have been caught relatively. Fishers lie a lot about how much they catch. And so you have to take it with a grain of salt, but they're all going out and they're also doing their own surveys, usually around spawning aggregations or, you know, in and out of MPAs, so they can monitor the local fish population. So Oregon has a fish and wildlife, Washington has a fish and wildlife, right? All the states have individual fish and wildlife that are monitoring their local catch. There's a lot of overlap, right? And so when we have these neighboring states that have like rockfish and things like that, that don't have barriers, right? They don't have borders, then there's a lot of working together, especially why I think a lot of our fisheries on the Pacific Coast are doing well is because we have three states with very similar, four states, Alaska actually, have very similar fisheries management strategies that can all work together. And it has to, because a lot of our fishing or our fish species go from, you know, Alaska, British Columbia, all the way down to Baja, right? So you have different managing practices. East Coast is kind of different, right? You have a lot of states that manage their resources very differently. So they might not be that collaborative effort or as collaborative. But then once you go down into, you know, Mexico, Canada, if you go up to Canada, especially, you have individual countries that have all very different types of fishing regulations, right? But they're sharing borders. And so I think this is where you start to get into a lot of the unregulated type of fishing industries. You might have a country that has very sustainable practices, but they might be neighbors to somebody that's giving their permits off to China, Japan, and things like that. Right. So we are very fortunate here to actually have one universal kind of, you know, and I don't necessarily agree with everything NOAA does, but I think in general, they are doing a fairly good job. I think it's really hard to monitor a lot of our fishing, our fisheries here. So, you know, and then it takes a long time just with the bureaucracy of getting things through, like changing regulations, changing fishing practices. And so if you're not up to date on a lot of those fishing, you might actually see that, hey, there's, you know, ground fish, lingcod or something like that, our, you know, populations are going down. By the time it goes up the chain and a decision might be made, that fishery could crash. So I wish they could speed that up a little bit. But in general, I think we're doing a much better job than most. I mean, Norway, I don't know much about Norway. I think I'd like to jump more into Norway. But most of these other countries, I think we're doing a really great job compared to those. I think that's all I got for the lecture. Questions? Yeah.
I think there's like different boat fishing regulations, like maybe one screen doesn't allow barn boats or something. Like, where do you find information?
That's all. So, great question. When you get your fishing license, you'd have to go to you couldn't buy it online. You'd have to go to a fishing shop. They would give you a little pamphlet, and it would be by each region, and then you could go to each watershed, and they would tell you the seasons, the fishing gear regulations, right, all that stuff. There are sections, especially once you get into like salmon and steelhead streams, like there'll be stretches of a stream that you have to crimp down your barbs. You can't have any barbs whatsoever, or certain regulations on the number of flies or the number of lures you can have. It's on you to know all that. So I got a ticket one time, and it was one of the few times I was fishing with my wife. We're fly fishing in the Owens Valley. And so I have a fishing spot that is my go-to to always catch fish. And it's in the it's called the Wild Trout Wilderness of the Owens. So it's barbless, two flies at max. And so it was like my second time my wife was going out fishing. So I was tying everything for her and making sure I wanted her to catch a fish, because like the more she catches fish, the more she wants to go fishing. That was my idea. I just got to get her to catch fish. And so I made a mistake, and one of her flies, I did not crimp down the barb. And so all of a sudden a ranger comes up, and I was like, oh, ranger, okay. Just like, she's like, oh my gosh, are we in trouble? I'm like, no, everything's cool. And this is such a small fly, super, super, super small fly. So you can hardly see the barb. And so he has a camera on his phone. This is like specialty phone. It's like a huge phone. Took a picture, zooms in, and he's like, you see that? Like, there's the barb's not fully crimped down. And I was like, you can actually see where I had tried to. So you see the grooves of my pliers, but it did not crimp it all the way down. So I'm giving him my old spiel, like, you know, I'm a professor. This was like, I'm a researcher. Like, trust me, like, I have no bad intentions whatsoever. And he's like, sorry, dude. And got a ticket. It was $650. For a barb. So they for any fishing regulations in California, they do not mess around. If you take one more lobster than you're supposed to, if you have an undersized lobster, if you especially take like a giant sea bass, or you have more than your 20 bag limit, you will get fined and you will never do it again. Like, that's their intention, and it works. And it was my mistake, but I was like, you can't, like, shit, like, of all people,
like that little thing, like, you got to plant that, or didn't plant it, like
the barb. So it's the barb on the hook. So when you have that barb, so it's supposed to be like when you bite in, it can't come out, right? And so it could be destructive, especially to like juvenile trout. It could like rip their mouth a little bit. So in order to prevent that, you crimp down the barb. So it's basically like this now, and so that way they, if they do come out, they won't rip their barb. It's harder to land the fish, right? So you have to like keep constant pressure, but it benefits the fish. But so I didn't crimp. You could see all the marks of where I tried to, but it didn't go all the way down. Expensive mistake. Yeah. But that's your management at work, and it's working, because I guarantee you there's a lot of people that, like, you get fined that way and you're never going to do it again. It's not like a speeding ticket, which still speeding tickets like a lot. Like, this was more expensive than any speeding ticket or any ticket that I've ever gotten, right? So the management here, the oversight, the enforcement is actually pretty good. There's a lot of areas, especially like if you go down to Mexico, they have marine protected areas and they're really nice. They don't have the resources necessarily to enforce. So there's still people going in and fishing them because there's no enforcement or very little enforcement. We have the enforcement here. So. Cool. Let's take a break and then we'll jump into exploring some data. So maybe we'll just do like a 10 minute break. 45. Be back at 45. I'll get this situated.